In October 1944, the last major naval battle of the Second World War was fought between the United States of America and the Japanese Empire. In the Battle of Leyte Gulf, the Imperial Navy tried to destroy the United States Pacific Fleet and defeat an American invasion of the Philippines. The result was the greatest naval battle in history. At Leyte Gulf, 280 warships and 200,000 sailors and airmen fought a series of furious naval engagements by night and by day over a vast area of ocean. There was almost every kind of fighting known in sea warfare, from carrier strikes to full battleship actions. Leyte was also the first battle of the war in which the Japanese used the suicide tactics of the kamikaze. For Japan, Leyte Gulf was intended to be the decisive battle which would halt the American advance across the Pacific. In reality, the Japanese Navy's last great gamble would lead to its complete destruction as a fighting force. After Leyte, the United States Navy would command the Pacific Ocean, and there would be nothing the Japanese Empire could do to save itself from total defeat. It was the Battle of Midway in June 1942 that had marked the turning point in the Pacific War. By attacking Midway Island, the Japanese had hoped to draw in and destroy the few American capital ships left after Pearl Harbor. However, instead of being the unsuspecting victims of a Japanese ambush, the outnumbered American aircraft carriers attacked. At Midway, American strike aircraft sent to the bottom four Japanese carriers and a cruiser for the loss of one carrier and a destroyer. It was a devastating blow to the Japanese and the greatest defeat ever suffered by the Imperial Navy. In the wake of the victory at Midway, American commanders were keen to go on the offensive and push back the boundaries of Japanese conquest in the Pacific. The plan was a three-stage campaign codenamed Operation Watchtower. The center of Japanese power in the Southwest Pacific was Rabaul on New Britain. With its formidable air and naval forces, Rabaul was far too strongly held for an immediate American invasion to succeed. Instead, in the first phase of Operation Watchtower, the Americans meant to take the Santa Cruz Islands and the Eastern Solomons by amphibious assault. At the same time, the Japanese would be driven from northern New Guinea and then from the rest of the Solomons. The final phase would be the seizure of Rabaul itself. It was Japanese activity on the eastern Solomons island of Guadalcanal that completely changed the emphasis of the American plan. Reconnaissance revealed that an airfield was being built. Soon, planes from Guadalcanal would be able to support new Japanese offensives in the region. The capture of Guadalcanal and its airfield was now made the first objective in Operation Watchtower. On the morning of August the 7th, 1942, a massive naval and air bombardment announced the arrival of the American invasion flotilla at Guadalcanal. The landings met little opposition, and by the next morning, the airfield was occupied. The American landing forces at Guadalcanal were 19,000 strong, but the Japanese believed they were much weaker. As a consequence, rather than go on the defensive, the Japanese fed in reinforcements and began to counterattack. Instead of the speedy conquest that the Americans had expected, the battle for Guadalcanal grew into a protracted and bloody campaign. It also became a magnet that drew strong naval forces into the area. In 4 months of savage actions around Guadalcanal, both sides suffered heavy losses in ships and men. The Japanese lost an aircraft carrier and two battleships, while two carriers were lost by the Americans. Other capital ships were severely damaged, and more than 30 cruisers and destroyers were also sent to the bottom. At sea, Guadalcanal had developed into a grinding battle of attrition. By the end of 1942, the Japanese effort to maintain their forces on Guadalcanal had finally been strangled, and the troops were hungry and barely supplied. However, on the American side, total troop strength had grown to 50,000, and by now they were extremely well supported. Finally, the Japanese realized that the battle was hopeless, and on February the 1st, 1943, they began to withdraw, leaving behind 24,000 dead. Hundreds of aircraft and their highly trained air crew had also been lost. With Guadalcanal, the strategic initiative in the Pacific War had passed once and for all to the United States. In the autumn of 1943, the Japanese perimeter in the Central and Southwest Pacific ran past the Marshall Islands, the Gilbert Islands, through the Solomons north of Guadalcanal, and cut across New Guinea. In the Southwest, the American strategy was now to isolate the Japanese base at Rabaul rather than storm it. And from September, there were landings on the northern New Guinea coast, and the start of a drive up the Solomons. The push in the Central Pacific began on November the 20th. From Hawaii and the New Hebrides, the invasion fleets of Operation Galvanic struck at the Gilbert Islands of Makin and Tarawa. After heavy fighting, the islands were secured on November the 23rd. In January 1944, another amphibious force from Hawaii launched Operation Flintlock, the invasion of the Marshall Islands. On Kwajalein and Eniwetok, the Japanese fought to the last, but by the 23rd of February, the islands had been captured. American carrier-launched aircraft also obliterated the massive Japanese air and naval base on Truk in the Carolines. The next major American objectives were the islands of the Mariana chain. In particular, Saipan, Tinian, and Guam. The Saipan invasion armada, carrying 127,000 troops, was supported by an awesome array of naval might. In company sailed a force of 13 escort carriers, 7 battleships, and 17 cruisers. Nearby was the Pacific Fleet's main striking force, with 7 new battleships, 13 cruisers, 69 destroyers, and 15 fast aircraft carriers. In spite of the shattering bombardment from the heavy guns of the American warships and the determination of the amphibious assault, the Marines quickly found themselves facing real difficulty in getting off the beaches. The Japanese commanded the heights and launched fierce counterattacks. There was also another, even more deadly threat from the sea. The Japanese had anticipated the Mariana landings, and a powerful fleet of carriers, battleships, and cruisers began to implement Operation Argo, a massive counterstroke that would destroy the American carrier fleet. The result was the Battle of the Philippine Sea. Starting at 08:30 on June the 19th, the Japanese carriers launched 4 successive waves of strike aircraft. However, unlike the Japanese, the Americans had efficient radar, and the attackers were detected in plenty of time. The American carriers scrambled hundreds of fighters to meet them. In a series of savage battles, 240 Japanese aircraft were shot down for the loss of only 29 American planes. Already, American submarines had sunk 2 Japanese carriers, and the day after the Great Air Battle, an American carrier strike sank another. In all, Japanese aircraft losses came to 480 planes, along with most of their crews. With the American victory in the Battle of the Philippine Sea, the conquest of the Marianas was a foregone conclusion. There was still bitter fighting to come, but by August the 12th, Saipan and the neighboring islands of Tinian and Guam had been cleared, and the Marianas were in American hands. Now the question for US planners was where along the still vast perimeter of the Japanese Empire should the United States strike next? Although the American president, Franklin D. Roosevelt, took the closest interest in the conduct of the war, alone amongst the leaders of the great powers, he never thought of himself as a strategist. He was known for asking penetrating questions, but usually he followed the advice of his Joint Chiefs of Staff. However, in 1942, he had insisted on reinforcements being sent to the battle for Guadalcanal. And now, in the summer of 1944, he was about to intervene once again. Throughout the campaigns on New Guinea and the Marianas, the Joint Chiefs had been divided on the question of where the next attacks should be. Roosevelt was getting conflicting advice from all sides. On July the 21st, the president took matters into his own hands. He traveled to Hawaii to meet with the two men who actually ran the war in the Pacific. Chester Nimitz, commanding Central Pacific operations, and Douglas MacArthur, commander in the Southwestern Pacific. Faced with the choice between MacArthur's desire to drive the Japanese out of the Philippines and Nimitz's preference for bypassing most of the islands and striking at Formosa, Roosevelt backed MacArthur. The general had used the kind of arguments with which Roosevelt instinctively sympathized. Above all, the political reasons for taking the islands from which America had been driven at the start of the war. Although others would have to be convinced, the president's support for MacArthur's plan made it almost certain that America's next major campaign would be to expel the Japanese from the Philippines. On July the 18th, 1944, after the disastrous defeats in the Marianas and the Philippine Sea, the government of Hideki Tojo resigned, and Lieutenant General Kuniaki Koizo became Japanese Prime Minister. Koizo was a retired Army counterintelligence officer and a hardline nationalist backed by the Army faction. Within Japanese ruling circles, a peace party had tried to win the premiership for itself, but had been too weak to do so. Although it did succeed in getting the appointment of Admiral Mitsumasa Yonai as Navy Minister, and in practice, Vice Premier. However, even with influential backers, Yonai could make little headway. The Japanese public had been told that the empire was winning the war, and the hardliners would not hesitate to arrest or assassinate anyone who openly advocated peace. Privately, Koizo doubted that Japan could hold out against the growing might of the United States. Nevertheless, he supported the military faction who demanded one last chance to improve Japan's bargaining position by winning a major victory. Under Koizo, creating an effective defense would be given the highest priority. But an important part of that defense would be to strike a major blow against the Americans, preferably a blow that destroyed an entire US invasion force. On August the 28th, 1944, Task Force 38, 14 aircraft carriers protected by battleships, cruisers, and destroyers, set sail from Eniwetok in the Marshall Islands and headed for the Philippines. Under the command of Admiral William F. Halsey, Task Force 38's mission was to attack Japanese air power on the islands, weakening the opposition in advance of America's next move. General MacArthur's plan to liberate all the Philippines, even though it was backed by President Roosevelt, had not yet been accepted by the Joint Chiefs of Staff. But whatever the next campaign, bases would be needed in the southern Philippines. Plans to invade at least some of the islands had already been laid. The American intention was to seize the islands of Ulithi and Yap, the Palau Islands, Moratai, and the Talaud Islands. These could be used as staging posts for an invasion of Mindanao, the southernmost of the Philippines. After the Japanese had been driven from Mindanao, Leyte would be invaded. However, there was still a question about what would come next. The possibilities were Luzon and the complete clearance of the Philippines, or the bypassing of Luzon in favor of a leap to Formosa. On the 13th of September, Admiral Hulse's flyers flew 1,200 sorties against targets in the Philippines, and a similar number the following day. Almost 500 Japanese aircraft were destroyed, two-thirds of them on the ground, for only 9 American losses. The carrier planes had also sunk 59 ships, with as many again counted as possible sinkings. It seemed to Hulse that the strength of the Japanese defense on the Philippines had been seriously overestimated, as had the Japanese will to fight. In particular, it looked as though the island of Leyte was especially weak. Wasting no time, Hulse sent a message back to headquarters reporting that the Philippines were barely defended and suggesting an invasion of Leyte as soon as possible. Even as Hulse's message was being received at Pearl Harbor, in the Canadian city of Quebec, President Roosevelt, Winston Churchill, the British Prime Minister, and their senior commanders were meeting at the Octagon Conference. In the middle of the meeting, a message was received from Nimitz at Pearl Harbor telling of Hulse's suggestion that landings be made at Leyte. By the end of the day, the Joint Chiefs had issued orders for an invasion of Leyte to be mounted on October the 20th, 1944. The operation would be codenamed King II. Admiral Hulse's report completely changed the American timetable for the campaign in the southern Philippines. The Palau Islands, Moratai, and Ulithi would still be taken. But Yap, the Talaud Islands, and Mindanao would be bypassed in favor of an early landing on Leyte. After that would come the invasion of Luzon that MacArthur had always wanted. The landings on Leyte would take place at Leyte Gulf, an area of good beaches, and one of the few anchorages big enough to hold and protect the invasion flotilla of 7th Fleet. As well as transporting the assault troops of 6th Army, 7th Fleet would have the task of protecting and supporting the landings. Destroyers and patrol craft would guard against Japanese submarines. Battleships and cruisers would use their heavy guns to bombard the enemy on shore. Escort carriers would give fighter cover to the troops and bomb Japanese positions. While 7th Fleet carried out the landings at Leyte Gulf, to the west and north, Task Force 38, the strike component of 3rd Fleet, would be deployed to support the invasion force. Its carriers would attack Japanese air bases all over the region and deal with any major Japanese naval threat that might appear. However, Most American commanders doubted that the Japanese Navy would launch any large-scale operations against the Leyte landings. By the summer of 1944, the strategic situation for Japan was growing more and more dangerous as each day passed. In aircraft carriers, the Japanese Navy was desperately weak, while the timing of the various American attacks in the Pacific had kept Imperial forces off balance. Twice, the traditional Japanese Navy doctrine of seeking out the decisive battle had been followed to the letter, and twice, at Midway and in the Philippine Sea, it had failed to deliver an American defeat. With the perimeter of the empire being pushed back step by step, and with ships, trained men, and resources of all kinds in ever shorter supply, the choice for Japanese planners was a stark one. Either accept a slow and inevitable defeat, or try once more for the decisive battle that would stop the Americans in their tracks and perhaps open the door to an honorable peace. To win such a victory, the Imperial High Command would have to concentrate all its available forces for one massive counterblow. With the American capture of the Marianas and New Guinea, only the screen of islands from the Japanese homelands through the Ryukyus, Formosa, and the Philippines protected the flow of oil and other strategic supplies which were the lifeblood of the Japanese war effort. In the new Japanese strategy, the southwestern area, the main source of Japan's raw materials, was to be heavily fortified. So was the island chain linking the area to the Japanese homeland. Most army and navy aircraft would be deployed along the chain. At the same time, the Japanese army would move troops from Manchuria and, with the navy, create amphibious forces which could be sent to any area under attack. Most of the Japanese surface fleet was stationed in the southwest, off Singapore. However, the aircraft carriers had to be based in Japan to reform their air groups. It was hoped that in November, the carriers could join the rest of the fleet near Singapore, creating a powerful combined force. The Japanese defense relied on four operational plans called SHO. SHO 1 was for the defense of the Philippines. SHO 2 for Formosa, the Ryukyus, and southern Japan. SHO 3 for central Japan, and SHO 4 for the north. In fact, the Japanese were nearly certain that the American attack would be launched against the Philippines. But wherever the assault, it would trigger the convergence of all available Japanese forces, naval units, land-based air power, and amphibious infantry units. Under the onslaught, the American invasion force would be overwhelmed and completely annihilated. Admiral Chester Nimitz had been appointed Commander-in-Chief of the United States Pacific Fleet in December 1941, shortly after the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. More than anyone, it was Nimitz who had restored the morale and offensive spirit of the Pacific Fleet in the aftermath of the disaster. The Pacific Theater had traditionally been the special preserve of the United States Navy and the undisputed domain of the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet. However, since the start of the war with Japan, the Army had also been heavily committed, mainly because of the need to defend Australia and New Zealand. The seal was set on increased army influence when General Douglas MacArthur, regarded as a hero by the American press and public, set up his headquarters in Australia. The result was an extraordinary arrangement in which MacArthur was given command of the Southwest Pacific region and Nimitz the Central Pacific. Nimitz did his best to ensure that this unprecedented division of command should have a chance of working. However, no amount of tact on the part of the Pacific Fleet chief could change the dangerous reality. In the Philippines operation, there would be no overall American commander. Admiral Soemu Toyoda was appointed Commander-in-Chief of the Japanese Combined Fleet in March 1943. A widely experienced and able leader, Toyoda had been one of the many naval officers who had opposed the war right from the start. What was more, he had disagreed with the strategy that had been adopted, believing that Japan's plans for conquest were far too ambitious. A one-time chief of the Naval Technical Department, responsible for ships and equipment, Toyoda was well able to appreciate the dire situation in which Japan now found herself. Toyoda had always advocated the strategy of provoking a decisive battle to destroy the American Pacific Fleet. In spite of previous failures, he believed that Japan now had even less choice than before. With the show plans, Admiral Toyoda meant once more to try to inflict such a defeat on the Americans that they would be compelled to come to terms. His forces were weaker than ever, but if his fleet and his aircraft were used skillfully and boldly, he might yet win an historic victory. The Philippines invasion would involve almost the whole of the United States Pacific Fleet, and in preparation, the force was temporarily reorganized. Admiral Hulse's Third Fleet was stripped of its amphibious and transport elements, and these were given to Seventh Fleet, which would carry out the actual landings. That still left Hulse with a formidable strike force to protect the invasion. Task Force 38 had nearly 1,000 aircraft on 17 fast carriers, along with a powerful escort of battleships, cruisers, and destroyers. As an attack force which could undertake operations thousands of miles from any major base, Task Force 38 was unique. The Pacific Fleet's supply system was now so good that the task force could stay at sea almost indefinitely. The At-Sea Logistics Group, an armada of 34 oilers, storeships, refrigerator ships, and ammunition ships replenish the carrier groups at a series of pre-arranged rendezvous. Replacement aircraft and crew were delivered by three escort carriers, while eight others provided anti-submarine and combat air patrols for the supply ships. The logistics group also had its own protective screen of 19 destroyers and 26 destroyer escorts. While Third Fleet had grown in nearly 3 years of war to become the most powerful naval force afloat, Seventh Fleet had traditionally been the poor relation. Created in March 1943 to support MacArthur's campaigns in the Southwest Pacific, for most of its life it had been a modest force of submarines, troop transports, and escorts under Admiral Thomas Kincaid. Now, however, in the build-up to the Leyte invasion, it was becoming one of the largest fleets ever assembled. Of the 700 vessels now assigned to 7th Fleet, almost a quarter were warships. As well as his original fleet and his amphibious forces, Admiral Kincaid had Task Force 77, the powerful force of battleships, cruisers, destroyers, and escort carriers, which would provide close protection for the invasion fleet and fire support for the landings. The Essex Fleet carriers, the first of which was launched in July 1942, were at 27,000 tons the biggest American carriers yet. With a top speed of 33 knots, they were also the fastest. The Essex carriers could operate an air group of 82 aircraft and carry nearly a quarter of a million gallons of aviation fuel. A massive array of anti-aircraft guns gave the Essex carriers the ability to put up a powerful defense against enemy air attack. The carriers had 12 5-inch radar-controlled guns, 40 40-millimeter guns, and 60 30-millimeter weapons. Although the flight deck was not protected by armor, the hangar below was, and it would detonate a bomb before it reached the ship's core. By October 1944, 13 Essex-class carriers had been completed. Of these, 7 would take part in the battle at Leyte Gulf. The first of the Colorado-class battleships had been launched as far back as 1920. The ships displaced 32,000 tons, and their main armament was 8 16-inch guns in 4 turrets. The Colorados were protected by up to 18 inches of turret armor and 13.5 inches of belt armor. Deck armor was 3.5 inches. The guns of the Colorado battleships were capable of throwing a 2,100-pound armor-piercing shell, which could penetrate almost 19 inches of armor at nearly 7 miles. When the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor in December 1941, 2 of the 3 Colorado-class battleships were hit. Maryland was damaged, and West Virginia was sunk. However, both ships were successfully repaired and modernized. Too slow to accompany Third Fleet's fast carriers, Maryland and West Virginia, along with four other veteran battleships, were intended for shore bombardment duties at Leyte Gulf. What no one expected was that the old battleships would end up fighting a classic fleet action. The escort carrier was first conceived as a cheap way to provide anti-aircraft and anti-submarine cover to convoys carrying war materials and troops across the Atlantic. As the war in the Pacific had gathered pace, a new role was found for the escort carriers. They could relieve the fast fleet carriers of the task of giving air support to amphibious landings. By the end of the war, more than 100 escort carriers would be built, almost half of them of the Casablanca class. Displacing 7,800 tons, the Casablanca carriers had a top speed of just over 19 knots and could carry 28 aircraft. Unlike the fleet carriers, they had no armor, double hulls, or anti-torpedo blisters. As a result, because their official designation was CVE, their crews called them combustible, vulnerable, and expendable. 18 escort carriers would take part in the Leyte landings. Of these, 14 would be Casablanca-class vessels. By 1944, American carrier pilots, the men at the cutting edge of the war at sea, were trained to a higher standard than the flyers of any other navy. There was no shortage of high-quality recruits, nor were training programs limited by aircraft availability or fuel supplies. Even the rawest American naval aviator had 2 years training and more than 350 hours flying time. His instructors were also of the highest quality. Unlike the Japanese, who kept their pilots on operations until they were killed, the Americans rotated theirs through the training schools. The experience of veterans was continually passed on to new flyers, leading to a degree of tactical sophistication that the Japanese could no longer match. As for the sailors of the American fleets that would clash with the Japanese at Leyte, morale had never been higher. It was plain that the Pacific War had turned in America's favor, and although reverses could be expected, few doubted that the Imperial Navy would be defeated. Lengthy periods on operations had raised seamanship and gunnery skills to very high levels, and in both American fleets, there was a keen desire to come to grips with the enemy. At Leyte, the sharp spirit of aggressiveness which now permeated the United States Pacific Navy would change the course of the whole battle. Although the big surface warships of the Japanese fleet were now permanently based near Singapore, Japanese planners would much prefer to have kept them in home waters. Near Japan, they would have been close to the carriers, which had to be home to wait for their new planes and aircrew. The problem was that Japan was suffering from a desperate fuel shortage, and so the big ships had to be kept close to the East Indies oil fields. The cause of the Japanese fuel crisis lay with the activities of the American Pacific Submarine Fleet. 140 boats now prowled the Japanese sea lanes, and they had sunk 4 million tons of Japan's shipping. The Empire had neglected its anti-submarine defenses until it was too late, and by now it had lost more than half its oil tankers to underwater attacks. As a result, the Japanese Navy would have fuel enough for only one major sortie and would be unable to venture out again for another 2 months. For the Japanese, the worst possible scenario would be if the Americans attacked before the Imperial Carrier Force could unite with the rest of the fleet off Singapore. If that happened, the show plans would still have to go into operation, but the Navy would be forced to rely on its single remaining asset, the massive hitting power of its heavy surface warships. Japan could still field the big guns of 9 battleships and more than a dozen heavy cruisers. The ships had been fitted with the most up-to-date radar, and if they could get in amongst an invasion force, preferably at night, they could cause unimaginable carnage and destruction. Displacing a massive 64,000 tons, the Yamato-class battleships were the largest naval vessels yet built by any nation. Yamato and her sister ship Musashi mounted the biggest guns ever fitted on a warship. The main battery was 9 18-inch weapons in 3 triple turrets. Each turret weighed 2,500 tons, and the guns could fire an armor-piercing shell weighing nearly 1.5 tons over 26 miles. The ship's armor protection matched their firepower. Belt armor was up to 16 inches thick and could stop an 18-inch shell at 12.5 miles. Nine-inch thick deck armor could withstand the impact of a 1-ton bomb dropped from 15,000 feet. Yamato's anti-aircraft guns were also heavily armored. But this was as much to protect their crews from the blast of her own 18 inches than from anything the enemy might do. At Leyte Gulf, the gigantic Yamato and Musashi would sail at the heart of the Japanese battle line. The most numerous of all Japanese aircraft, the Mitsubishi A6M Zero fighter, was the mainstay of the Navy's land and carrier-based fighter squadrons. The Zero was a fast and highly maneuverable aircraft, which in the first year of the war had no equal. However, its performance had been achieved by keeping weight to a minimum, and that meant no armor plate, self-sealing fuel tanks, or armored windscreen. By 1943, the Zero had been outclassed by the new generation of American fighters in speed, firepower, and protection. Although the Zero was a fighter, some Japanese commanders realized that it would just be capable of carrying a 550-pound bomb. Flown by a courageous and determined pilot, willing to ram an enemy warship, the bomb-armed Zero could become the most formidable weapon ever directed at an American fleet. Although by the war's end, many different aircraft types would be used in kamikaze missions, the fast and maneuverable Zero would prove exceptionally well suited to penetrating the defenses of even the most powerful carrier task force. The Mitsubishi Ki-21 bomber had first entered service with Japanese Army Aviation in August 1938. The aircraft had spearheaded the bombing offensive in China and Southeast Asia, and at the time was as good as any twin-engine bomber in the world. Although by 1944 the Ki-21 Sally was obsolete and suffering heavy losses at the hands of Allied fighters, the aircraft remained in first-line service. In the Philippines, as part of a mixed force of Army Aviation bombers, Sallies would operate alongside Navy aircraft as part of the Show 1 plan. In 10 months to September 1944, the Japanese Imperial Navy had lost more than 5,200 pilots, 42% of its air crew. Most of these had been operating from land bases. As for the carrier pilots, the most highly skilled of them all, they had been virtually wiped out. The Japanese Army had also suffered catastrophic losses of aircrew, and at a time when aircraft production was up and substantial numbers were reaching the squadrons, there was a critical shortage of flyers. In Japan, both Army and Navy training schools had simplified their programs in the hope of producing more pilots in a shorter time. However, the consequence was a significant drop in proficiency. Chronic fuel shortages added to the problem. Flying time was drastically curtailed, and new pilots had virtually no combat training. The pilot problem was much worse for the carrier air groups. Normally, 400 hours in the air was needed before a trainee could even hope to master carrier operations. And pilots now came out of the schools with only 200. While both Army and Navy tried desperately to train the pilots they needed if they were to have any hope of defeating the next American invasion, the Japanese fleet near Singapore embarked on an arduous training program of its own. Particular attention was paid to anti-aircraft gunnery and night fighting tactics. The Japanese Navy had always come off best in night battles, and it was hoped that by the most careful preparation, even an enemy as powerful as the Americans could be outfought and humiliated. On September the 15th, 1944, General MacArthur's forces landed unopposed on Moratai in the Moluccas, one of the islands that was to be used as a staging post in advance of the Philippines operation. On the same day, Nimitz forces landed on Peleliu in the Palau Islands, intended as another staging post on the way to Leyte. The landing forces, the 1st Marine and 81st Infantry Divisions, had been led to expect little opposition on the Palau Islands. Instead, they faced 30,000 Japanese troops with a carefully planned defensive strategy. On Peleliu, the Japanese had transformed hundreds of caves into fortresses, and the Americans had to blast the enemy out of each stronghold in turn. In the end, the conquest of the Palaus would take more than 2 months, and the islands would play no significant part in the Leyte operation. Even as the fighting in the Palaus was still going on, the Leyte invasion force was already setting sail. On October the 14th, the last of the troop transports and warships of 7th Fleet left their anchorages in New Guinea, bound for Leyte Gulf, more than 1,200 miles away. The landings were to take place in 6 days' time. The American landings on the Palau Islands and Morotai in September 1944 were a sure sign to the Japanese that an invasion of the Philippines could not be far away. On October the 4th, radio monitoring detected the aircraft carriers of the American Third Fleet assembling. At the same time, in Moscow, the Japanese learned from the Russians of an American plan to bomb Formosa as part of a coming Philippines campaign. The Russians were America's allies in the European war, but ally or not, Moscow preferred that the United States did not win the war in the Pacific too quickly. On October the 9th, the Japanese Imperial High Command alerted its forces in Formosa and the Philippines. However, the show plan was not to be implemented at once. Because of the fuel shortages, Japanese commanders could not risk concentrating all Imperial forces, especially naval forces, until they were certain of exactly where the American invasion was to be. When the Americans had actually begun to land, then the great counterattack would be unleashed. Altogether, the American forces which were taking part in the Leyte operation numbered over 800 ships of all types, with 1,500 carrier aircraft to attack Japanese air and ground forces on the Philippines. ,143,000 American naval personnel were manning the transports, escort vessels, and carrier aircraft. In fact, more Pacific Fleet personnel would take part in the Leyte landings than had belonged to the entire United States Navy only a few years before. Army aircraft would support the effort. B-29 superfortresses based in China and Saipan, and B-24s based on New Guinea and newly captured Morotai would attack Japanese oil centers, airfields, and troop concentrations. The United States 7th Fleet commanded by Vice Admiral Thomas C. Kincaid, was divided into three task forces for the Leyte landing. Task Forces 78 and 79 had mostly amphibious transport, patrol, and service vessels. Task Force 77 would protect the landings and was under Kincaid's personal command. Of Task Force 77's many units, two groups would take part in the naval battles at Leyte. Task Group 77-2 was commanded by Rear Admiral Jesse B. Oldendorf. Oldendorf had six veteran battleships, three heavy and two light cruisers, and 15 destroyers. Task Group 77-4 was commanded by Rear Admiral Thomas L. Sprague. Sprague had 18 escort carriers and a screen of 10 destroyers and 14 escort destroyers. Backing 7th Fleet was 3rd Fleet, commanded by Admiral William Halsey, and for the Leyte operation, consisting only of Task Force 38. The task force was made up of four task groups, with altogether 9 heavy and 8 light carriers. Escorting the carrier forces were 6 fast battleships, 7 heavy and 10 light cruisers, and 48 destroyers. The task force was commanded by Vice Admiral Mark A. Mitscher, but throughout the battle, his superior, Halsey, would retain complete tactical control. The success of the Japanese defensive strategy laid out in the show plans depended above all on the performance of land-based air units. It was beneath the umbrella of these forces that the Japanese naval counterstrokes would be launched. In early October, the numbers of aircraft that the Army and Navy together deployed in the threatened region had risen to over 1,100 planes, with 500 more available as reinforcements. There were also more than 200 belonging to the aircraft carriers, whose air groups were by now only weeks away from being fully trained. It was hoped that land and sea-based Navy pilots would together be able to deal with the American warships, while the Army flyers, never trained to attack ships, concentrated on the beaches and anchored transports. The core of the Japanese combined fleet was the carrier force of 3rd Fleet, based in Japan's inland sea. Commanded by Vice Admiral Jisaburo Ozawa, 3rd Fleet had 1 heavy and 5 light operational carriers, along with 2 battleships fitted with flight decks as hybrid carrier battleships. As a screen, 3rd Fleet had 3 light cruisers and 10 destroyers. 5th Fleet was commanded by Vice Admiral Kiyohide Shima and was also based in Japan. 5th Fleet had 2 heavy and 1 light cruisers and 7 destroyers. 2nd Fleet was commanded by Vice Admiral Takeo Kurita. The fleet was based near Singapore and had 7 battleships, 11 heavy and 2 light cruisers, and 19 destroyers. Land-based naval air power was provided by 1st Air Fleet in the Philippines and 2nd Air Fleet from Formosa to southern Japan. As part of the show plan, the Army Aviation Units of 4th Air Army in the Philippines would cooperate with naval air forces, but would not be under a unified command. A key part of the Japanese defensive plan was that by surprise attacks, the overwhelming American superiority in carrier forces should be eliminated. The greatest hope of the Japanese commander-in-chief, Admiral Toyoda, was that before any American landings actually took place, he would get a chance to launch his land-based aircraft against the big American carriers. If Toyoda could destroy or cripple the main American striking force, any invasion would almost certainly be delayed, giving him the thing he needed most: time to strengthen his island defenses, finish training his carrier air groups, and unite his carrier force with the rest of the Imperial Fleet off Singapore. Before the American invasion fleet had even set out for the Philippines, the fast carriers of Task Force 38 had assembled west of the Marianas. Task Force 38's mission was to attack Japanese air power over a vast area, from the Philippines to the Ryukyus, wreaking havoc before the Leyte invasion began. The object was to destroy as many Japanese aircraft as possible, on the ground and in the air. Installations and workshops were also targets. Anything that could disrupt the sending of aircraft reinforcements to the Philippines. Just before the landings, Task Force 38 would sail south to lie off the Philippines and support the invasion forces. The main targets for the four carrier groups of Task Force 38 were airfields on Okinawa in the Ryukyus, on Luzon in the northern Philippines, and on Formosa, the most important staging post for Japanese air reinforcements on the way to the Philippines. The first American strike was launched against Okinawa and neighboring islands on October the 10th. The Japanese reaction was to order Show 2 and Show 1 plans activated, but for air forces only. The carriers of 3rd Fleet would stay in port, but their air groups were ordered to ready their operational planes and crews at bases in southern Japan in case they were needed. On October the 11th, two American task groups sent fighter sweeps against Luzon. In the following 3 days, all four carrier groups concentrated their attacks on Formosa. On the first day of strikes against Formosa, Admiral Halsey's carrier aircraft flew nearly 1,400 sorties against the island's 26 airfields. They also hit shipping. Japanese fighters were ready and rose to meet the attackers, but their pilots were poorly trained and hopelessly inexperienced. The defenders were clawed out of the sky, and the Americans caused severe damage to airfields, hangars, and headquarters. Although the American attacks on Formosa were causing immense destruction, the Japanese Navy Commander-in-Chief, Admiral Toyoda, did not see them as a disaster. Instead, the admiral believed that here was the opportunity he had been waiting for. On October the 12th, the Japanese flew over 100 bombing and torpedo sorties against Task Force 38. And from the start, the reports sent back by pilots told of massive destruction of American ships. The question for Admiral Toyoda was, should he now throw in everything he had to finish off the Americans once and for all? Toyoda made his choice. He ordered the carrier air groups, waiting on land bases as instructed, to join the strikes. The reports which came back from the latest waves of attacking pilots caused rapturous celebrations throughout Japan. Imperial General Headquarters announced that off Formosa, two American battleships and 11 carriers had been sunk and many more damaged. In fact, as reconnaissance soon showed, the Japanese pilots had wildly overestimated their success. The American carrier fleet was intact, and more than 800 Japanese sorties had succeeded in seriously damaging only two cruisers. American fighters and anti-aircraft gunners had shot down 500 aircraft, including half of Japan's newly trained carrier pilots. Admiral Toyoda's gamble had been a disastrous failure. On October the 17th, leading ships of the American invasion armada were spotted by Japanese coast watchers approaching Leyte Gulf. Soon after, the Americans were reported to have landed on an outlying island. The Japanese Second Fleet had already been alerted, and now it was ordered to sail for Brunei to refuel en route for the Philippines. The following day, the Japanese Imperial High Command activated Show 1 for all defending forces, sea, air, and land. By now, the first American shells were falling on the beaches at Leyte. The barrage of heavy gunfire by 7th Fleet's Shore Bombardment Group continued throughout October the 19th, and on the morning of the 20th, the shelling reached a climax. On two beaches, 13 miles apart, hundreds of landing craft surged towards the shore. Japanese opposition to the landings on Leyte was relatively light. For the moment, the strategy was to fight only delaying actions. By the afternoon, the Americans had secured the beachheads, and General MacArthur, alongside President Osmeña of the Philippines, was wading ashore, fulfilling his promise that one day he would return. What neither MacArthur nor any of his commanders knew, was that the Japanese planned to smash their invasion fleet at its anchorage in Leyte Gulf in 5 days' time. After raiding Formosa, Task Force 38's carriers steamed towards Leyte to support the landings. The carriers of the Japanese Third Fleet now sortied from Japan in pursuit. In the Japanese plan, Third Fleet would attack with what remained of its air groups. But its real role was to act as a decoy, luring the big American carriers away from Leyte Gulf. On October the 22nd, the Japanese Second Fleet sorted from Brunei in two divisions. Force A had 5 battleships, including Yamato and Musashi, 10 heavy and 2 light cruisers, and 15 destroyers. Force C was made up of 2 battleships, a heavy cruiser, and 4 destroyers. Fifth Fleet was already on the way from Japan, with 3 cruisers and 7 destroyers. Force A would sail north of Palawan, through the Sibuyan Sea, and on through the San Bernardino Strait, heading for Leyte Gulf from the northeast. Force C would sail north of Mindanao, through the Surigao Strait, followed by the cruisers of Fifth Fleet, and approach Leyte Gulf from the south. Meanwhile, 1st and 2nd Air Fleets and 4th Air Army would join in an all-out air attack against the Americans at Leyte on October the 24th. On the 25th, called by the Japanese X Day, the naval forces would attack simultaneously from north and south, and between them, crush the American invaders. American naval intelligence had quickly discovered that the Japanese Second Fleet had left its anchorage off Singapore, but since then had no information about its movements. Air reconnaissance had been stepped up, but nothing had been found. It was 2 submarines, Dace and Darter, that finally succeeded in locating the Japanese battleship force. Not only did they send a full report to 7th Fleet, but with torpedo attacks, they sank 2 heavy cruisers and crippled another. Admiral Kurita's flagship was one of the victims, and the Japanese fleet commander had to be plucked from the water by a destroyer. The American submarine's contact report was enough for Admiral Halsey to launch his own scout planes on the morning of the 24th and prepare to follow up with a massive strike against the Japanese fleet. At the same time, the long-planned Japanese counterattacks by aircraft from the Philippines were unleashed on the American carriers. Of almost 200 aircraft launched by the Japanese in raids of over 50 at a time, only a handful broke through. The American carrier's combat air patrol shot down over 60 raiders. However, one Japanese bomber did find its target. It scored a direct hit with a 550-pound bomb on the light carrier Princeton. There was a series of violent explosions, and the hangar deck was engulfed in flames. As most of Princeton's crew abandoned ship, the cruiser Birmingham closed and directed the firefighting effort. Suddenly, a tremendous explosion racked the carrier and raked the crowded decks of Birmingham with a storm of deadly splinters. 229 men were killed and 236 injured, to add to more than 100 fatalities already suffered by the crew of the doomed Princeton. By now, the battleships of the Japanese Force A were just about to enter the Sibuyan Sea. Of Task Force 38's four groups, Task Group 1 had earlier been ordered back to base to replenish and had just been told to turn around and rejoin the force. Task Group 3 was to the north and had just borne the brunt of the Japanese air attacks. However, Task Groups 2 and 4 were well placed to attack the Japanese in the Sibuyan Sea. At 09:10 on the morning of the 24th of October, Task Group 2 launched the first of three strike waves, followed by another from Task Group 4, altogether 259 sorties. As they attacked the massive Japanese fleet in the Sibuyan Sea, the American planes met a wall of anti-aircraft fire. The battleships were even firing their main batteries at attacking aircraft 10 miles away. Japanese air commanders on the Philippines had chosen to attack the American carriers rather than defend Admiral Kurita's fleet, and so only a handful of Japanese fighters were patrolling over the ships. The Americans lost only 18 planes, mostly to anti-aircraft fire, while the giant battleship Musashi was hit by 19 torpedoes and 17 bombs. Yamato, her sister ship, was hit by 2 bombs, but while Yamato steamed on, Musashi sank, taking 1,000 men with her. Heavy cruiser Miyoko was another victim, damaged so badly she had to return to base. Although the American pilots had sunk Musashi and cruiser Miyoko was knocked out, no other Japanese heavy ship was significantly damaged in the Sibuyan Sea. However, just as the Japanese flyers had done in their battle off Formosa, the American pilots greatly overestimated the number of ships they had sunk and believed they had completely neutralized the enemy fleet. When the Japanese were seen to make a course change, which would take them home, Admiral Halsey concluded that the fleet was no longer a threat to American forces at Leyte. In fact, the course change was temporary, and the Japanese Force A was still a massively powerful concentration of naval might. By the morning of October the 24th, the Japanese carriers of Third Fleet, led by flagship Zuikaku, was off northern Luzon. The fleet had not yet been detected by the Americans, and Admiral Ozawa's intention was to strike with the few aircraft he had and then try to lure the American carriers after him. By 11:15, Ozawa's search planes had found the carriers of Task Group 3. 30 minutes later, Ozawa launched a 76-plane strike. It was the last strike launched by Japanese carrier aircraft in World War II. Almost all the attacking aircraft from Ozawa's carriers were intercepted by American fighters, and many were shot down. The task group's anti-aircraft fire accounted for more, and only a few Japanese planes broke through to launch their bombs and torpedoes. They failed to hit a single ship, and only a handful of Japanese aircraft survived. hope remained for Ozawa's force now was to fulfill its last suicidal function, to decoy the American carriers away from Leyte Gulf. Ozawa sent some of his ships directly towards the Americans, and as he had hoped, they were soon detected. His main fleet was spotted by late afternoon. To Admiral Halsey, the sighting of Japanese carriers only served to confirm a suspicion that had been growing in his mind for some time, that the Japanese would never mount a major operation without a carrier fleet. What Halsey could not know was that Ozawa's carriers were a spent force. Halsey's orders from Admiral Nimitz had been to watch over 7th Fleet and its landing forces at Leyte Gulf. However, if the chance came to destroy a major part of the Japanese fleet, the annihilation of the enemy was to get top priority. Believing that in the Shibuyan Sea he had already knocked the Japanese battleships out of the picture, and that Ozawa's carrier force was the main Japanese threat, Halsey ordered a full-scale pursuit. It had been Task Group 3 off Luzon that had found the carriers of Admiral Ozawa's 3rd Fleet. Admiral Halsey's orders were for Task Groups 2 and 4 to steam north and join with 3 to attack the Japanese. There was discussion of a plan to guard the San Bernardino Strait with Task Force 34, a strong force of battleships and cruisers. But the plan was not put into effect. Instead, the ships raced north with the task groups in pursuit of the Japanese carriers. Not a single American warship was left guarding the passage. By now, Force A, with its 4 surviving battleships, had left the Shibuyan Sea and was poised to pass through the San Bernardino Strait. It completed the passage in the early hours of October the 25th. Meanwhile, to the south, Force C with its 2 battleships was off Mindanao. 50 miles behind followed the cruisers of 5th Fleet. Although the Americans had lost track of the northern Japanese pincer, their aircraft had spotted Force C. And they were now sure an attempt was about to be made to reach Leyte Gulf through the Surigao Strait. Shortly after noon on October the 24th, after the Japanese had been detected approaching the Surigao Strait, every ship in 7th Fleet was alerted by the fleet commander, Admiral Kincaid, to expect a night attack. In Leyte Gulf were 56 transports and amphibious ships, including the cruiser on which General MacArthur was based. The first step was to throw a screen of escort destroyers and patrol boats around the ships, and all traffic in and out of the Gulf was ordered to stop at sunset. Meanwhile, 7th Fleet's commanders prepared to fight the most devastating action in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. Because the Japanese clearly intended to enter the Surigao Strait at night, neither the escort carriers of 7th Fleet nor the army bombers in the region could be of any help to the defense. an action would have to be fought by surface warships, and that meant the old battleships and cruisers of the Shore Bombardment Force, commanded by Rear Admiral Jesse Oldendorf. Oldendorf made painstaking preparations. He would have the fleet's destroyers, and with these, he was determined to weaken the Japanese before the big ships engaged. The Admiral ordered his forces to take up positions across the northern end of the Surigao Strait and make ready to meet the enemy. The American battle line would be made up of six battleships, which would steam east and west across the Surigao Strait. To the north was placed a column of six destroyers, Destroyer Division X-Ray, to guard against enemy submarines. In front of the battleships were placed two groups of cruisers, right and left flank. The left flank cruisers were screened by the nine destroyers of Destroyer Squadron 56. The right flank destroyers were Destroyer Squadron 24, with six ships patrolling a north-south line. A picket of seven destroyers from another command, Destroyer Squadron 54, was already operating on both sides of Hibusan Island. If the enemy approached up the strait, as expected, Oldendorf would have succeeded in executing the classic naval maneuver of crossing the T. The highest tactical ambition of any fleet commander. The American battle line would be able to fire full broadsides, while the enemy would be unable to bring all its guns to bear until it could maneuver, and by then it would be too late. The American defenders at Leyte had no aircraft available which could operate at night. 7th Fleet had to rely for information on 13 groups of radar-equipped torpedo patrol boats, 39 in all, which were sent on the afternoon of the 25th to find the enemy. The PT boats made their first contact with the Japanese fleet at 22:50. For the next 4 hours, they launched one frenzied torpedo attack after another. No Japanese ships were hit, but at the cost of a single boat, a constant stream of reports reached the waiting American warships in the Surigao Strait. Next to attack were the destroyers of Squadron 54, which sighted the enemy column at 02:45 and raced towards the Japanese fleet at 30 knots. As it entered the Surigao Strait, 4C was sailing with the battleships Yamashiro and Fuso and cruiser Megami in column, with four destroyers as a screen ahead. Destroyer Squadron 54 attacked in two groups. The first section raced down the strait and launched its torpedoes at 0300, hitting Fuso, which fell out of formation, sinking. 9 minutes later, the second section launched its torpedoes. Three of the Japanese destroyers and the battleship Yamashiro were hit. Two of the destroyers were sinking, and all three were knocked out of the fight. But Yamashiro continued to steam on. The Japanese column was now reduced to Yamashiro, the cruiser Megami, and the destroyer Shigure. Thank you. Altogether, 47 torpedoes had been fired by the first two destroyer groups to attack in the Surigao Strait. Five Japanese ships had been hit, of which three had been sunk or were sinking. It was a superbly well-executed attack, one of the most successful destroyer actions of the whole war. But Four Seas' ordeal at the hands of Seventh Fleet's destroyers was not yet over. As the right flank and then the left flank destroyers attacked, Yamashiro was hit again twice, and the damaged destroyer Mochishio was sunk. Altogether, the American torpedo attacks had accounted for 75% of the firepower of Force C. Meanwhile, the guns of the American cruisers and battleships, 64 of them massive 14 or 16 inch weapons, prepared to fire on the approaching Japanese column. The first American ships to open up were the right and left flank cruisers. Of the battleships, it was those with the latest radar that fired first: West Virginia, Tennessee, and California. Between them, they shot off 93 rounds of 16-inch and 132 rounds of 14-inch armor-piercing shell in six-gun salvos. The cruisers fired more than 4,000 rounds. Overwhelmed by the storm of fire, Mogami and Yamashiro took hit after hit. 5 minutes after the American line had opened up, both ships were ablaze and slowly retreating. At 0419, the battleship Yamashiro capsized and sank, taking with her the force commander, Admiral Nishimura, and almost all her hands. Only the blazing cruiser Mogami and two destroyers, one badly damaged, were able to retreat back down the Surigao Strait. At first light, American aircraft from 7th Fleet's escort carriers were sent to find the remnants of Force C. During the night, the cruisers of the Japanese 5th Fleet had also begun to enter the strait, but had quickly fled, one of their number torpedoed by an American PT boat. Now they were the object of an intensive search by American aircraft and a chase by Oldendorf's fleet. Cruisers, carrier planes, and army bombers would finish off all the crippled ships from both Japanese forces, while of the whole Japanese southern force, only a cruiser and five destroyers would survive. While the night battle had raged in the Surigao Strait, to the north, Admiral Kurita's Force A, with its four remaining battleships, had passed through the San Bernardino Strait entirely unopposed. The Americans at Leyte were still assuming that Admiral Halsey had left the battleships and cruisers of Task Force 34 guarding the passage. But that plan had never been put into effect, and the ships were racing north, with Halsey, in pursuit of the Japanese carrier force. At 0400, on the morning of the 25th, Admiral Kincaid sent a message to Halsey asking him to confirm that Task Force 34 was on station. However, the message would not be received until 0700, and by then, it would be far too late. Admiral Kurita's battleship force was steaming straight for the escort carriers of 7th Fleet. The Americans had, as yet, sent out no reconnaissance aircraft, and radar indicated nothing amiss. The escort carriers, which now stood between the battleships of the Japanese Force A and the American invasion fleet at Leyte, were in two groups lying off Samar. Call signs Taffy 3 and Taffy 2. Further to the south was the third group, Taffy 1. While much of the shore bombardment force was chasing the retreating Japanese after the battle in the Surigao Strait. It was an anti-submarine patrol plane from Taffy 2 which first sighted the Japanese fleet only 20 miles from Taffy 3. The aircraft immediately radioed its report to the carriers. The time was 06:47. Almost at the same time as the American patrol plane reported the massive Japanese force bearing down on Taffy 3, the two fleets came in sight of each other. The effect was to cause complete consternation on both sides, but it was the Japanese, with the far stronger force, who would make the mistake. Admiral Kurita ordered general attack in the middle of a routine maneuver without waiting to form a battle line. The result was chaos, with the Japanese ships rushing piecemeal towards the American carriers. On the American side, Taffy 3's commander, Rear Admiral Clifton Sprague, reacted with complete presence of mind. He at once made a course change into the wind and ordered all his planes launched. Every ship was to make smoke, and the carriers were to increase speed to flank 17.5 knots. At a range of 19 miles, the Japanese big guns opened fire. As the salvos marched closer and closer to the escort carriers, Taffy 3 broadcast in plain language a desperate appeal for help. Meantime, the only hope was to run for it, and at the same time, counterattack in the hope of at least distracting the enemy. Aircraft from Taffy 3 and nearby Taffy 2, armed with whatever was to hand, including depth charges and rockets, were already attacking furiously. It would take time before properly coordinated strikes could be mounted. But meanwhile, Taffy 3's screening force of three destroyers and four smaller escort destroyers would have to be sent against the Japanese cruisers and battleships. Their chances of survival were slim, but they might at least delay the enemy with torpedo attacks and confuse him with smoke. The charge by Taffy 3's destroyers and escort destroyers, launched straight at the Japanese fleet, was so determined and aggressive that the enemy was thrown into total confusion. The destroyer's torpedoes knocked out a Japanese heavy cruiser and forced the big ships into wild, evasive maneuvers. However, in spite of the extraordinary courage of the American destroyers, at 07:50, the carrier, Kalinin Bay, took the first of 14 enemy shells. White Plains was also hit. At 08:10, Gambia Bay dropped out of formation, listing heavily. hit again and again. Within half an hour, she was dead in the water and sinking. By now, American bombs, torpedoes, and gunfire from the carriers and destroyers had badly damaged or sunk four of the Japanese heavy cruisers, for one American carrier and three of the defending destroyers lost. The Japanese fleet was in utter disarray, and Admiral Kurita had completely lost tactical control. At 09:25, he ordered his ships to withdraw and regroup. To the Americans, it seemed like a miracle. For 2 hours, Admiral Kurita weighed up the options. The fury of the American destroyer and air attacks had led him to believe that he had engaged a far more powerful force than actually existed. He had intercepted the American pleas for help and feared reinforcements would soon arrive. He had also received a message from Luzon, warning, incorrectly, that an enemy force was approaching from the north. As for attacking Leyte, he had just heard of the disaster that had befallen Force C in the Surigao Strait, and knew that his fleet was alone. Intending to engage the non-existent enemy force to the north, Kurita ordered his ships back towards the San Bernardino Strait. Although the escort carriers of Taffy 3 had escaped destruction at the hands of Admiral Kurita's battleships and cruisers, their ordeal was not yet over. Early that morning, Taffy 1, to the south, had been hit by the first kamikaze suicide attacks of the war, damaging two carriers, and Taffy 3 was the next target. Less than 2 hours after the end of the battle with the Japanese fleet, the escort carrier, Kitkun Bay, was hit by a kamikaze, and another hit St. Lo, bursting through the flight deck and detonating torpedoes and bombs. Blazing from stem to stern, St. Lo went down at 11:25. Before the day was out, the total of kamikaze victims was one carrier sunk and six damaged. A handful of pilots, willing to die, had achieved more than all the big guns of Admiral Kurita's battle fleet. While 7th Fleet's escort carriers were under attack off Samar, Admiral Halsey's Task Force 38 had caught the Japanese decoy force off Cape Engano. Halsey still believed that Admiral Ozawa's impotent force was a full-scale Japanese carrier fleet, and he was determined to smash it utterly. Starting at 0800, Halsey launched six powerful strikes. The attacking aircraft swept aside the few fighters the Japanese carriers had left and savaged Admiral Ozawa's fleet. By late afternoon, the four carriers, Zuikaku, Zuiho, Chitose, and Chiyoda, had been sunk along with a destroyer. American submarines and cruisers later added another light cruiser and two destroyers to the tally. Although Admiral Azawa escaped, his third fleet was all but eliminated. While Admiral Halsey had been destroying Azawa's carrier fleet, another prize, almost as great, had escaped him. He had delayed before sending carriers to intercept Admiral Kurita's battleship force retreating to the San Bernardino Strait. And at extreme range, his planes failed to sink any of the ships. However, the Japanese carriers were gone, and with them, the biggest single threat to future American operations in the Pacific. At Leyte Gulf, the Americans had defeated the last coordinated Japanese offensive of the Second World War and had won the greatest naval battle ever fought. The Japanese Imperial Navy had lost 3 battleships, 4 aircraft carriers, 6 cruisers, and 8 destroyers. Hundreds of aircraft, including the last of Japan's carrier air groups, had been destroyed. Losses of sailors and airmen were more than 10,000. On the American side, the cost of victory at Leyte had been only 1 light carrier, 2 escort carriers, and 3 destroyers. Fewer than 1,000 American sailors and airmen had died. By winning the Battle of Leyte Gulf, the United States Navy had guaranteed General MacArthur's ultimate victory in the Philippines, although there was still hard fighting to come. And with the fall of the Philippine Islands, just as the Japanese High Command had feared, the flow of oil to Japan from its East Indies Empire quickly dried up. Next, for the Americans, would come the invasions of Iwo Jima and Okinawa, the assaults that would open the door to the Japanese home islands and guarantee that whether it came quickly or after a hard and bloody struggle, victory would come.